sunrise. A wash of warm colors. It belies the true nature of this island, a fractured black rock tossed up from the belly of the earth. Beautiful, yet dangerous. Exactly the nature of the day. They've come from around the world to throw themselves against this razor-edged terrain. Swim, bike, run. A simple formula, a simple creed. Finish whatever it takes. It's shortly after dawn in the small fishing village of Kailua Kona on the big island of Hawaii. This is the 19th running of the Gatorade Ironman Triathlon, and in all these years it has become one of America's great sporting events, due in part perhaps because its images, as cool as they are familiar to us all. But one of the most lasting images is that special look that all the competitors have in their eyes, from first timers to the great champions when they enter the water, because they know there's a lot that can go wrong out there. Especially if you're the target of every elite athlete in this race. What if you've come to symbolize the name Ironman, and today you race for the final time? Lucky to even be alive. His body still not healed, chasing demons more than a championship. An NFL career behind you, more than 100 miles ahead of you, carrying 300 pounds the entire way. 78 years old, an American hero. But honorable men have been humbled here before. Shakespeare said youth is wild, maybe a touch reckless as well. There's never been an iron teen. Battle the course, battle your body. No one has ever overcome this man's challenge. It's time for the start, and here in the water, they're thinking currents, distance, a kick in the chest, a wayward stroke. And there's 138 miles after this. Daunting, but very doable. At the start, the elite triathletes get a 10-yard buffer from the rest of the field. It protects their ability to win. The cannon unleashes 1,500 people, 5,998 arms and legs.
The Pacific Ocean has been turned into a sea of ambition. I'm at the turn in the swim, the first target of many on this day. You know, 2.4 miles doesn't seem too long in a Gatorade Ironman, which goes for 141 miles. But you know, a year ago, one of the pre-race favorites did say to me he knew a minute into the swim he wasn't going to have a great day. And you know, I wonder how many think that right now. Rest assured, for everyone, this is going to be a very long, long day.
The next step comes on wheels, a world well known by three-time Tour de France winner Greg LeMond.
Imagine, after 1 hour in the water, these athletes have to ride 112 miles on their bike. That's the equivalent to two of the hardest time trials I ever had to do in the Tour de France. And then they have to run a marathon.
That's 26.2 miles, equal to the Boston or New York City Marathon.
Here we go.
That marathon is a long way off for former U.S. Olympic swimmer Lars Jorgensen. Already he's separated himself from the turbulent sea of everyone else.
It's the eighth time Greg Welch has cut a trail through the Pacific Ocean in a Gatorade Ironman, but the first as the previous year's winner. As he kisses the salt water, his mind must fight to forget about the one who is feared by everyone. And here, in his weakest exercise and wearing number two, is Mark Allen. He's already locked on to Welsh. Also in the chase group is Paula Newby-Fraser, wearing the yellow cap, number 33. And with her is Karen Smyers. She too has made a great start and is right here with her. As the swim continues, one thing's already certain. The favourites have found their place and they're all where they want to be.
The people on the turnaround boat scramble to identify the first swimmer they see. Lars Jorgensen, a 25-year-old from Knoxville, Tennessee, is on a record-breaking pace. The Gatorade Ironman has never seen a lead like this at the halfway point.
And while Lars Jorgensen sighs to the ocean in search of the 9-year-old swim record, those who huddle behind know that his is a short-term target. Theirs is the ultimate goal. By the halfway turn, the private world of Messrs. Welsh and Allen see them in Siamese formation. The women have paired off too, and Karen Smyers has swept away the memories of 1994 when she lost her goggles and 4 minutes to turn level with the redoubtable Paula Newby-Fraser. Perhaps because of the favoured start, the element of luck is removed and the best has already focused on their rivals.
Amazingly, not too far off the pace the professionals are setting, John McLean pulls himself through the water. In order to be the first wheelchair athlete to complete the Gatorade Ironman, the 29-year-old from Sydney, Australia, will have to cover 141 miles using only his arms. Every triathlete has their favourite discipline of the three. This isn't it for 300-pound former NFL offensive lineman Darrell Haley. No one this big has ever attempted the Ironman.
I'm 6'5". This morning I weighed at 295. People say, you ever played football before? Nope, I am a triathlete.
I know what it is from TV. The Ironman triathlon, celebrity athlete. Do that.
He's gonna do that?
He said he was.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Join me? He'll probably change the sport with his arrival.
Yeah, I think so.
For me, the bottom line is to finish and finish any way I can, you know, and still be able to say, hey, you know, I did the Ironman.
There is nothing except being the best or desperately trying that Darrell Haley will accept. Every day he looks at his hand, the one with the ring. He remembers the NFL, Super Bowl 20, and New England.
Once I retired, there was a huge void. It was a void that I still wanted to compete. I still wanted to get out there and have the desire, you know, to challenge myself and see just where I can go with it. The first time I saw the Ironman on TV, you know, my thought was, this is really insane. This is unbelievable. People actually do this. And I never even thought in my wildest days that I would be willing to do something like that. But once I learned more about it, I wanted to be a part of it. And today, I love saying that I am a triathlete opposed to a ex-professional football player. Right now I'm weighing 295 pounds. If I get down to 250, I think I can definitely do very well in a race, and in some cases, maybe even win a race. I will win a race. That's a definite. At some point, I will win one. That's my life goal for triathlon.
On that other field, Darrell Haley knows what to expect. This is not that field. Here, 2.5 miles is like 4th and 50. Possible, but tough. He must beat the cutoff of 2 hours and 20 minutes, or the bike and marathon won't be necessary.
Like a shooting star viewed from afar, Lars Jurgensen homes in on Kailua Pier. And the swim record, which has held since 1986, is set to be annihilated by almost a minute. Ambitions achieved now, Jorgensen's effort is expected to be paid for in full during the lonely hours ahead as he races into the less hospitable zones of cycling and running.
Greg Welch is a better swimmer than Mark Allen. That's why Allen has done a good job in that through the frothy Pacific, he sees Welch is right there. The pier is moments away.
In solitude, Jurgensen races to his bike. Despite his lead, the advantage from now is with those with the proven pedigree.
Newbie Fraser, yellow cap 33, knows Karen Smyers is still close because of those annoying fingertips that keep hitting her feet. Just ahead, with this Ironman nearly concluding its first hour, the women's leaders, including Wendy Ingram and joined by Welch and Allen, rise and run directly into the frantic, disorienting world of transition. Greg Welch is only 3 seconds ahead of Mark Allen. After all that swimming, one little mistake here and it's instantly gone.
And Karen Smyers beaches ahead of Paula Newby-Fraser, but Newby-Fraser is making her point here on the runout. Smyers is beginning a frantic search for bag number 34, one of 1,500.
Fuel tanks loaded, feet getting buckled in. Greg Welch is away and up the hill. The cheers for him die down, and then there are more behind him. That's when he feels the presence of Allen, still right there. It's time to load up.
Into the transition area, like the seven-time champion she is, Newby-Fraser knows the essence of speed and of urgency. Karen Smyers, in her third attempt at victory, knows the importance of being so close to the champion. Opening round to Smyers, a faster transition, she's away. Newby-Fraser, confident her 11th Gatorade Ironman will be well, pretty much like seven others, leaves behind her. But those few seconds, saving to put feet in the pedals, have profited for Newby-Fraser. She's out onto the open road first. And for Karen Smyers, this has been a dream start. She can now look forward to the 112 miles of heat and hell which the lava fields are guaranteed to generate. After his voluntary sabbatical, Mark Allen is back in his playground of the lava fields, where he laid the foundations to his wins between 1989 and 1994. His main concern is thought to be the Australian Greg Welch, the plucky winner of a year ago. Both have already disposed of the early leader, Lars Jurgensen. Each now expect the next move to come from the German, Jürgen Zach.
There's one man to fear on the bike. This is him. Zach holds the Ironman cycling record. And it's no surprise, he's part of that great European cycling tradition. He almost looks with disdain at the swim and the run.
The track records of the men are holding true, and Karen Smyers is having a tough time reversing a predictable course in her half of the event. And that's keeping up with Paula Newby-Fraser, driving hell-bent, trying to break the spirit of those not as strong. Jürgen Zach is making his statement and the first man to be seen by volunteers and fans. Checking the lead, he turns and finds a familiar face in Thomas Hellriegel. Hey, thumbs up to that. The Germans have flown like a Porsche past Alan Welch and everyone else. The wind feels like a wall. What's surprising is 24-year-old Hellriegel, a German soldier, just keeps going and grabs the lead. A great rider like Zach, but with military training. Dangerous combination.
Greg Welch and the rest of the chase group are going to have to watch this German assault. In conditions this windy, a strong cyclist can break away and bury the field. Mark Allen says that the Ironman is won or lost during the run. But this brutal wind makes everything so unpredictable. Zach and Hellriegel are already out of sight.
Today, the painted canvas of the Big Island is Karen Smyre's chosen art form on which she rides from a position of strength. She's fighting to establish her finest chance to win. Wendy Ingram has been the early leader after the swim, but already passed by newbie Frazier, history repeats as she's passed too by Smyre's. Just one rider, one of great stature, remains ahead. It's an uncomplicated contest.
The blur of the heat can't hide the fact that Hellriegel has selfish intentions. His lead is 30 seconds over Zach and growing. Remember, there is no speed limit on the Autobahn.
On this crowded road, the chase pack contains Mark Allen and Greg Welch, but they're now a minute and a half behind Hellriegel. This early in the ride, that's already quite a margin, and they haven't even reached the windiest part of the route yet.
Way back in Kaitalua Kona, the other race continues, and the parade of waterlogged bodies makes this look like any other Ironman. Then John McClain comes out of the water.
I would hope that you think that I'm another competitor, not that I'm singled out because I have a disability. I'm hoping that you'd look at me and say, well, there's another athlete having a go at the Ironman.
It's difficult to share John McClain's modest view, to see past the obstacle that confronts him. Paralyzed from the waist down, attempting what no one has done before. Seven years ago, McClain was a successful rugby player in Australia. He was hit by a truck while riding a bike. A little more than a year ago, he took up triathlon. Today, he's the lone wheelchair athlete in this sport's greatest event.
I'd hope that if there's some disabled kids watching, maybe in my country or around the world, that are just sitting there watching television, and they might see me and hopefully might give them some stimulus to do something. It doesn't necessarily have to be triathlons, but to get involved and not be a spectator, get involved and get into life.
You might ask, why in the world would he put himself through this? And he might respond, what do you want me to do, sit home and watch? I don't think so. Ex-football player, triathlete, Daryl Haley is still battling the currents and the clock. Cut-off time, the final gun, is drawing near.
Back with the women, Paul and Ivy Frazier has opened a three-minute gap on Karen Smyre's.
She's burning a lot of energy on this ride, but this is the way she's always done it.
This is the men's chase group approaching Harvey and the turnaround. 52 miles have been covered in wind and now rain. Thomas Hellriegel, the great unknown in his first Gatorade Ironman, is showing little respect to the elements or the competitors of note. In a countryside so like his native Germany, he's come here to win.
The Hawaiian water is 84 degrees. You could probably swim in this all day. Hundreds of friends, people like you, see the fish, take your time. Forget it. 9:20 and out, or your Ironman is over. With only 6 minutes left until the deadline, it sounds like a football game has broken out. Fourth and 50, Darrell Haley, 34 years old, 300 pounds, is in the end zone. Which means his game goes on. Wife Sheba is there to celebrate this brief timeout. But this is where the coach yells, "Hey, Darrell, you've got 139 miles to go."
Locked into a position that personifies the triathlete Paula Newby-Fraser leans on the wind as she moves towards Harvey, and a four-minute lead over Karen Smyers. Her bike rocking to the turbulence, Karen Smyers heads towards Harvey. She knows the elements are not her only problem right now. The flags show the wind to be doing its best to keep the riders away from town. And although they'll make it, at what cost to their strength for the rest of the day?
Hellriegel is already there. A solo effort like this takes so much more out of you.
Thomas Hellriegel of Germany is in Harvey. He's approaching the turn here, almost 53 miles into the bicycle race. And what a race this has been. He's faced the toughest wind since 1983, and it's been very, very hard. Now he will turn. He'll pick up the tailwind. What's more, he'll see exactly how well he is going, because all of his rivals will be coming at him on the opposite side of the road.
Hellriegel's built a three-minute lead, and like Paula Newby-Fraser, he's out there by himself. Jürgen Zak is in a tougher spot. Does he risk trying to catch Hellriegel, or does he fall back to the chase group? Or does he stay where he is, and that's no man's land?
Well, while Jürgen Zak considers his options, maybe this will help him make up his mind. Hellriegel headed in the opposite direction. Drafting is illegal, of course, but there's no denying there's more comfort when in the pack. 6 minutes behind the leader, Mark Allen rides in his own private world. Near him, though, is champion Greg Welsh, and like Allen, he too must wonder just what the Germans are capable of. Welsh, the only non-American to win this race, might also be thinking the turn of the European has arrived. Harvey, an oasis in the lava fields, and this part of volcanic Hawaii has long since settled. And every year its people welcome the competitors of the Gatorade Ironman. The men have gone, and now they see for the first time the leader of the women, Paula Newby-Fraser. Her lead is 5 minutes over Karen Smyers. First timer Thomas Hellriegel continues to stamp his authority on this race. Those who have allowed this particular fish to run now know not even a tight line may bring him back. Jürgen Zak has found his match and rides alone 6 minutes behind in second place. Renaissance man Mark Allen is 8 minutes off, and all are losing ground to the young German who is on a mission.
How many minutes to Jürgen?
Eight minutes
to Jürgen?
German intrusion is getting bigger. Rainer Müller is moving through the field as well. Welsh, like Allen, is finding the German chess game a little off-putting. And Hellriegel is beginning to look like a grandmaster.
What a beautiful day.
Good job.
Hey, brother. Hey, Ma.
John McClane's spirited heart should be examined by scientists, who should include his upper body while they're at it. Out there, in the world, he's just one of the game. You put in, you take out. It's a rate of exchange everyone here understands. And the finish line is where you cash your checks. Symbolically for some, literally for others. Paula Newby Fraser has made this a career, and after 11 straight appearances, decided her triathlon age is 65. Retirement day. An 8-minute lead. There's a party to get to. 2 years ago, Karen Smyers was fourth here. Last year, she was second. Included in her preparation this time was being a counselor at Paula's very own triathlon camp. Now, a camp like that is for learning. 80 miles into the ride, we're about to see if she paid attention in class.
For Thomas Hellriegel, this is an extraordinary bike ride, one he may not appreciate until he tries to repeat in a year's time. In the windiest conditions for more than a decade, he's coming in with a time close to the best ever. This on a day when, frankly, survival would be gratifying enough. And Jürgen Zach, so often the trendsetter in the bike section, is now 8.5 minutes back. It has not been a case of giving the lead to Hellriegel. Hellriegel's just taken it.
Here he comes, Germany's Thomas Hellriegel, doing his first ever Gatorade Ironman, leading off the bike.
Hellriegel's performance defies description. The great Hawaiian crowd knows it, and Hellriegel knows it. His time of 4 hours, 29 minutes and 37 seconds is arguably the best ever performance in the bike section, just 2 minutes off the record on a grim day.
Imagine what's going through the minds of Mark Allen and Greg Welch and every other rider in that chase group. I'd be worried if I was 13 minutes behind. No one has ever come back from that far down. Maybe Allen and Welch shouldn't have paid quite so much attention to each other.
Hellriegel must make the most of his gains and persuade his tired legs that this race is not over. There are still 26.2 miles to go. Now he must enter the furnace of the lava field and the intensity of the energy lab. His final two challenges in his bid to become the first European winner. More than 30 minutes behind, Welch and Allen, beaten men or men who have a foresight that can only come from experience. The runner, as always, holds the answer.
There are favorites, and then there is Thomas Hellriegel. He exited the swim 5 minutes after the favorites and then became Stephen King, riding an Ironman shocker as he dusted the field, building a 13-minute lead on the bike. For him now, the marathon is a mile old. The best one he's ever run, a 2:57. Respectable, not fast. Jürgen Zach pre-race was all psyched for the bike. Now, not leading in the marathon, you wonder if he's not psyched out.
Are they in already?
They're not back yet. Ach du lieber, only a few strides toward 26 miles, and he's thinking ahead, but more about behind, where Mark Allen, Greg Welch, and company roll to the transition.
Thomas Hellriegel came to beat the finest Australian triathlete ever and the world's most accomplished champion who fears no one. We're 2 miles into the run here. The German is embarrassing them both. Now they can see his lead. A boost for him. A morale drop for those who follow. Perhaps. And Paula Newby Fraser is winning her battle with the wind, stretching her lead over Karen Smyers to 10 minutes. That's about 5 miles of road between them both.
Waiting in the bike transition for the Allen Welch group, fans in the know check their watches. Down by 13 minutes plus. Is victory still possible? Their marathon best times, even that of Raina Mueller, were better than Hellriegel by about 13 minutes. This race could go down to the final inch.
He's a three-time finisher. There's Mark Allen. There's Blake Welch. Right behind them.
More water outside. More water outside.
Where'd you put them over
there?
Lothar Leder and Raina Mueller are first away from the changing tent. It's 13 minutes since Hellriegel left, and Mark Allen, usually confident and in charge, is finding what a difference a year makes. Unbelievably, the Germans with Leder and Mueller are holding the top four places now. Champion Greg starting his favourite section. He trots with confidence. Behind him, the grip of Mark Allen. It seems to be relaxing. One thing's for sure. The run must be something very special from them both.
Thomas Hellriegel, the German soldier, continues to lead the march. He knew the best marathon time he'd ever had. He'd have to be better. Jürgen Zach probably wishes he could have the thumbs up that he gave to Hellriegel back. It was not meant as a signal for him to go and win. And there's another countryman in Raina Mueller, taking in support any way he can. Germans 1, 2, and 3, but not 4, as Mark Allen reels in Lothar Leder. And as the pace of the race quickens, Greg Welch slows. Back spasms. 2 miles in. A lot can go wrong out there. For all his spirit and success, this looks like a fade to black. Allen now locks his sights on third. And Mueller, he's taking prisoners and no gifts.
Now, Jürgen Zach made his annual bid to crush the field in the bike ride, and instead, a countryman had crushed him. Zach is now firmly in the sights of Mark Allen, a champion fighting out of the corner Germany has pushed him into. The coolest runner in the business is being tested to the full.
Paula's no different. She knows the desert-like conditions of the lava fields lie ahead.
With the heat intense and still no sign of Hellriegel, Jürgen Zach is the immediate attraction to Mark Allen. His relentless and consistent pace has systematically killed off those ahead, one by one. Not yet halfway through the marathon, Allen has climbed from fifth to second. And you know Zach needn't look over his shoulder. Not anymore. His bike ride has again not been good enough.
Cycling and running are no different. When you have the talent of a champion, you'd rather be the hunter. Hellriegel's 13-minute lead is cut in half, and Mark Allen's got to love this.
Paula Newby-Fraser wants only to win, but like Thomas Hellriegel, the Zimbabwean is also beginning to falter. For the first time since the race left the ocean, she's slowing down. And Smyers, like Mark Allen, her race is not lost yet. And the time checks indicate that after 6 miles of the run, she's taken back a full 3 minutes from Newby-Fraser.
It's called the Energy Lab, an overly scientific name for what's really an oven fueled by lava rock and an angry sun. Historically, this is a big U-turn, where the Ironman crown is won and lost. Thomas Hellriegel's 13-minute lead is now less than 5. But Mark Allen has only 9 miles left, to pull off what would be the greatest comeback in Ironman history.
The Energy Lab, its very name, often a misnomer, can be the watershed for the bravest of athletes. Thomas Hellriegel is experiencing the loneliest day of his life, and now he faces up for the first time to the man who is haunting him. Mark Allen was once almost 14 minutes back. Like a robot in perfect control of his functions, Allen has moved in. He's just 3.5 minutes behind. This race is down to just two men. The brave German attacked in the bike ride to have any chance of winning. But for the first time in 7 hours, his body is objecting to the torture.
This day, now almost 8 hours old, began when Allen came out of the water almost 4 minutes ahead of Hellriegel. The 24-year-old Ironman rookie was a shocking 17 minutes faster on his bike. 37 years old and driven by a force only he understands, Allen is making good on his word. The Ironman is a runner's race.
When you get out there and you're racing for 5, 6, 7, 8 hours in the sun, in the heat, with the wind, the fantasy falls away and you're left with what I call a raw reality. And I like that because it's real.
The raw reality is this. For the first time since about 9 o'clock this morning, Mark Allen can see Thomas Hellriegel's back, and it's getting closer. The young German who's led so well, so long, so strong, now feels what countless others have felt, the grip of death. 5 titles in a row before taking last year off. And now he returns this year for what his wife said will be his final time. Mark Allen has chased Thomas Hellriegel for nearly 6 hours with patience few of us know. Cat and mouse means cunning, tortoise and hare slow and steady, fox and hound respect and eventual victory. They're all alive right here on a road called Queen K. Mark Allen's done much in his career, but nothing equals this. Barring the unimaginable, Mark Allen has just pulled off the greatest comeback in the history of this event.
The Energy Lab again awaits friend and foe. They're all the same to this barren outpost. Paula Newby-Fraser is about to know what Thomas Hellriegel felt like minutes ago. She crosses with Karen Smyers. The feeling can't be great. 9 miles to go, and Karen Smyers is looking the fresher. Paula Newby-Fraser hears the news, and it's not good. More than 6 minutes lost since the marathon start. But that still leaves Smyers with a lot of catching up to do.
They should probably give Mark Allen a piece of a Lee drive, because after all, he does own the road. Earlier this week, he said he had a feeling something incredible was going to happen come race day, and he wasn't sure that it would involve him, but it would be amazing. Well, it did, and it has been. Former triathlete Julie Moss with son Matt waits for dad at the finish. A lot of people questioned his return after a year off, and people do become beatable someday, don't they? Well, they all gave it their best shot. Hellriegel, Zach, Mueller, later, Welch. and they all failed. 6 Ironman championships. That'll tie the men's record of Dave Scott. And if this is Allen's final Ironman, he is leaving on top of the game. He said that in every other Ironman he's run, he ran out of anger, feeling he had to prove something or to fill some hole in his life. He said this is the first one he's run for himself, and credits Julie and Matt for giving him a new outlook. Some things change when you become a father. Some things remain the same. Mark Allen is the 1995 Gatorade Ironman champion. This then is the 6th Gatorade Ironman triathlon leaderboard with Allen at the top. It shows the Germans to be a force that must still work on their running, but 1-2 that will return with determination. Greg Welch 4th, Jürgen Zach 7th. And then this, one of the greatest stories of the day. Christian Bustos, who cheated death in a chilling accident in 1994, who continues extensive rehabilitation, still without full use of his right hand, he finishes in 6th place.
Thinking from Karen Smyers. Well, it does appear that Paula Newby-Fraser is experiencing the triathlete's biggest fear. She's hitting the wall. Her lead, 3 minutes with 4 miles to go, but surely that's enough. She's down. Newby-Fraser's hit a volunteer. She's totally disoriented. This is the cruel reality of the Ironman, but she's going on.
It was strange. She bounced right back up, got right back into the race as if nothing happened, and that is, as you say, either because she's very focused or totally out of it.
These last few miles to the finish now are going to be a long, long way for this young woman.
They started this day together, side by side, 9 hours ago, 140 miles ago. Paula Newby-Fraser built what seemed to be an insurmountable lead on the bike. But the Ironman isn't designed to be won or lost in the second, third, or even sixth hour. It is designed to be a test of everything you've got to the end. Paula knows that. The lead fell slowly, irrevocably, shrank. Dwindled, all but destroyed. Karen Smyers, constant, driving. Less than 2 minutes back with less than a mile to go.
Since 1986, Paul has been winning these Gatorade Ironmans, but that doesn't make them any easier or more pleasant. Mind you, this sport was never meant to be pleasant, but the reward is the great inner satisfaction felt from success. Newby-Fraser is not getting such a feeling. She's in desperate trouble. Mind is confused by the efforts of an extraordinary day. The 7-time champion in her final Ironman finds her body in turmoil. Her champion instincts alone force it onward.
Good, good. This is the final stretch, a downhill before the turn onto Ali'i Drive, home of the finish. When Newbie Frazier rounds that corner, she'll be just 400 yards, four football fields from the finish line. She's still trying to get water if she has it in her. This is going to be one incredible finish because Karen Smyers is right there.
And Smyers comes around the corner. She has her in her sights. Paula Newbie Frazier blissfully is unaware and quite frankly probably doesn't care right now.
Paula Newbie Frazier is slowing and now stopping. Staggered like a boxer. A tap from Smyers, who goes on by. And Paula would need one of the great recoveries and sprints to overtake Smyers.
Al, there's no way Paula is ever going to recover from this.
Phil, it is so uncomfortable seeing someone so dominant in the Ironman being so totally dismantled by the same event. Meanwhile, Smyers, who's been hearing it from the fans for the last couple of miles, they saw Paula Newbie Frazier first, then told Karen what they saw, and what they saw was a champion losing her stuff. Dehydration, exhaustion, the wall, they're powerful things, but they're far away from what Karen Smyers is feeling right now at the age of 34. To have one time been a short distance specialist, to come here to the Big Island of Hawaii and win this.
Six miles from the finish, Karen Smyers could never have carried a hope of winning this race. How time has changed. At one time, she was almost 12 minutes behind. She never lost hope or faith, and in the end, she has won her first Gatorade Ironman. The 34-year-old from Boston had only her third attempt, has never been worse than fourth. In 11 years of racing, she's never known injury or dropped out. Today, her reward is victory.
Meanwhile, Paula Newbie Frazier has the sneakers off, socks too, just grabbing every liquid she can in sight. Some event personnel are there. That's what we thought.
Watch behind for the other runners.
And what a contrast. Karen Smyers is the first American to win since 1985. And this is what's behind her on the road.
It's getting more frightening. Paula Newbie Frazier laying down in the middle of the road. Other finishers are running around. She can't be assisted or she'll be disqualified.
Getting cold water.
Paula's fiance, Paul Huddle. The news got to the finish line in a hurry.
She needs an ambulance.
Get an ambulance right now. 911. Who's got a cell phone now?
This is just a spectator on the side looking on. She happens to have a cellular phone.
Ambulance. Yeah, I got some. Wait a minute.
thinks I'm going to die.
Let's get her out. Let's get her out of here.
Ambulance on the way to a frightening scene. We'll be back.
Paul and Ibi Fraser is still on the ground, and this is first-timer Isabelle Mouton of France, and I think she'd have been happy with third, but now she's going to finish second.
This is going on 15 minutes of being down and out with a little delirium thrown in. No longer is Paul and Ibi Fraser chanting, I think I'm going to die. Medical aid on the scene, ambulance two.
Cold water, cold water.
She's getting doused. And she's drinking.
It had all seemed the foregone conclusion. Paul and Ibi Fraser was going to win again. Then the wall, then the appearance of Karen Smyers. Now all Karen wants is to see Paula safely home.
She needs your help. Let's help her on in. Come on, Paula! Come on, we're here for you!
Still, she's not moving.
She
has every intention of crossing the finish line. She has just told everyone if they leave her alone for a moment, she might just be able to finish.
I have all day.
Yes, you do.
You do, Paula.
Slightly indignant, Paula Ibi Fraser wants it to finish her way. Paula Ibi Fraser said, give me one more drink of water and I can walk to the finish. This is totally surreal. A little bit over 20 minutes, she has shaken off the delirium, the doctors, and everyone who said get in the ambulance and retire. No, she's going to retire after this 400 yards. And it seems as though she has completely roared the spirit of this Gatorade Ironman back to life. People have seen her finish as strongly as a triathlete can seven times. And yet when you take into account all the things that great athletes have, spirit, determination, courage, grit, maybe this is the finish that is the most special of them all.
And Paula Ibi Fraser today proves to be the great champion she always has been. She will not be the title holder this time, but she will finish just the same. And she will walk towards the line in third place here, despite the time she spent on the ground. And through on the inside is Brazilian Fernanda Keller. She's going to snatch third place from her. How cruel this race can be.
The events of the final few minutes from Mark Allen to Paula and Karen's resolve clinch it. The Ironman triathlon has seen its greatest day. No other one can touch the emotion, admiration, and disbelief.
Karen Smyers giving Paula a hug right here at the finish.
Well, if they were Team Psycho before, no telling what Karen Smyers and her Massachusetts friends will be like now. The best on Walden Pond, the Pacific, the world. In fact, she and Paula Ibi Fraser were so far and away the best that Paula's 20 minutes out of it and on the ground pushed her down to only fourth. The rest of the story in the Gatorade Ironman Triathlon in a moment. The sun is setting on the Big Island of Hawaii. The pros have long since crossed the finish line, but for hundreds, this day will linger long into the night. You want to be an Ironman, Daryl Haley? When you finish your ride, go run a marathon. Your arms are burning. Your spirit's tired? You still have dozens of miles to go, John McClain. They run on into the night, chasing a dream to be Iron Men, to be like their heroes. Perhaps to be like Paula. At least to someday be the one.
I've given this race my heart and my soul. You know, I really have given a lot to this race, and I can honestly say with that finish, I know why I'm not coming back to race it again. You know, there were moments where I thought I was going to die. I was going, oh my gosh, I'm going to give my whole life to this race. And but I wanted to finish, you know. There's, you know, like I said, no matter what happens, I wanted to cross the finish line.
Cross the finish line. No matter what happens, whatever it takes. And maybe, if you're lucky, you'll have a good day. Maybe a great day. Maybe a day for all time, like Mark Allen. If this is farewell, then all hail the conquering hero, the Iron Man. Husband, father, legend. Long after the sun has arced its path across the sky, they run. Spirits, apparitions, dancing through the shadows. How do you measure what it means to conquer this course? What gauge would you use to measure this man's heart, his handicap?
Hey, Mom, how you doing? You swim?
Oh,
shit.
Had a good swim,
didn't I?
Fabulous. Excellent.
Oh, shit.
Oh, you were smoking.
He braved the ocean just like the others. He challenged the black rock and searing sun just like the others. Like them in every way, save this. John McClain has covered 115 miles using only his arms. Now he faces a marathon, just like all the others. A bell, a clarion call, urging them, warning them. Ralph and Katy Perry, husband and wife, side by side the entire day. Finish by midnight, though, or you don't finish at all. That's the deal. Thinking of the finish, being at the finish, it is the only thought at times that puts one foot in front of the other.
Yeah, my philosophy was just do the best that I can all day. If I make the cutoffs, you know, that's super. And if I don't, at least I know I've done the best that I can.
That's why it is so cruel when the dreams go unfulfilled. There are effortless downhills, but every mountain has two sides. And sometimes the only way forwards is backwards. Doesn't last forever, but for those who bear witness, the memory of accomplishment always will. Fly, John McClane, like Mercury fly. Run, Lokalani, celebrate your youth. Be strong, Ralph and Katie, both in your 60s. Relish your youth as well. But remember the clarion bell's simple warning. Be there by midnight. It is 5 minutes after midnight. The bell has tolled. The deadline passed. Yet the Ironman credo still holds. Finish. Just finish. It lives in 72-year-old Bill Bell, who is cramped and dizzy, yet drawn to it. Drawn to it. It pulls each of them to this tiny island year after year to witness the Ironman, to be an Ironman, to finally touch the line.
Media accommodations provided by the Keauhou Beach Hotel.